Welcome to the video, everyone. I've been going over today, yesterday, history, and mistakenly believing the way to calm people down in the world is to be able to explain the origins of conflict here, the theological differences. It's not the way. It's not the way at all. What will calm people down here in this world is for them to realize there's another realm. There's another realm. That's what will calm people down here in the end times. That's it. They'll say, oh my, we're so tired of this place. So to just feel like there's another realm somewhere, you know, will give everyone pause to say, hey, we don't need to intensify this situation here. We don't need to come up with winners and losers here. As a matter of fact, none of us need this realm at all. We don't really need it. So let's talk about need. We're free to choose our experiencing. We're free, but we don't need to choose anything. Nothing has said, God has not said, you must experience this. So we don't have any needs. We don't need to experience this realm. If we don't like it, experience a different realm. Very simple. And yet here in this realm, you believe that there are no other realms, that this is the way reality is, that light pretends not to be light. Light obeys all these physical laws here instead of the will of spirit, which is what light really obeys. But it was the will of spirit to set up a realm where it seemed like light was disobedient and to spirit. Light wasn't light. So, of course, we don't like this realm, really. But we're frightened. We're frightened with, we have a severe continuity fear, and we also think, oh, there is no other realm. There is no other place for us. This is it. We have to learn to adapt and adjust to this. So, this is the Luciferian satanic way to say we must adjust and adapt to this realm, that this is it. And our happiness comes from adjusting and adapting this realm and beautifying this realm, okay? And beautifying this realm. That is the false teaching. We are absolutely free to experience any realm or any experience we want to at all moments. So why do we say we need to beautify this realm as if this is it? This is the base, this is our home, this is it, there's nothing else. Therefore, we need to beautify it. We need to make it peaceful. We need. The way to solve the problems of this world is to realize you don't need this world. You can't have this world and then solve its problems at the same time, because this realm gives false evidence about God, about truth, about identity. False evidence. You're never going to be happy with false evidence. Never. The premise is that of this realm is that God has preferences. The pure spaciousness has a preference as to what appears to it. Wants this to appear and this not to appear. That's not God. That's a lie about God. That's a false premise. So out of that false premise of preferences come adjustments. I need to adjust to make sure I'm seen in a preferential light. In other words, the light prefers me. Because we're afraid the light will not create our experiencing for us unless it's preferred, you see. So we're coming here to try to master the dynamics of preference of light. There are no dynamics of preference of light. There's nothing to master here, actually. There's nothing to master. The master is one who realizes there's nothing to master here. Light doesn't have preferences. We ask light to pretend to have preferences, to seem to have preferences, to set up a whole system where we could figure out what its preferences were. But it's all a wild goose chase. Time waster. Just time spent aimlessly wandering around. We don't need this realm. We absolutely do not need this realm. Nobody needs this realm, except for the continuity fear, which is fine, which is understandable. But the continuity fear accepted means a continuity fear that can be worked on. And so you can tell those who have accepted, repented and accepted, yeah, I do have a severe continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. They're working on the spiritual path very intensely. And the ones who haven't repented are not working on it. They're working on trying to beautify this world very intensely. You know, we've got to make ourselves happy here. There isn't any other place. You know, there's that kind of thing. But if you recognize I have a continuity fear, you say, of course there's other realms. I just am afraid to go there, afraid to, because I'm so used to this functioning this way. So I've got to overcome all this habitual familiarization and habits and false thinking and dualistic, relativistic thinking. You know, that this is preferred over this and judgment, all that stuff. I need to gradually melt and evaporate all that nonsense away. That's what the spiritual path is for. It takes some time. So oftentimes, those who have repented, often their favorite activity is simply to sit quietly in inner focus, concentration, focus, attentiveness. That's their work, that's their activity, that's all important to them. They're not hustling and bustling in the marketplace of the world. What motive do they have for that? None. They're not interested in this world anymore, in this realm, where the light appears not to be responsive, where the light appears to be disobedient, where the light appears to have preferences. It's all a fake. It's all a pretense. We told light to pretend this. The Luciferian rebellion, Luciferian means light of the light, it appears that the light rebelled. No, we told the light to do this, so we could pretend that we are greater than God, that we can change the very nature of reality. It's spirit that told light to do this. So there's no real rebellion. There's no real rebellion. There appears to be, it seems that way. But light is just pretending. But it's in this realm here, it's very difficult to truly know that light is just pretending. Because of all these physical laws of the universe and how everything seems to nature and all that, you know, this is all bizarre. This realm is completely bizarre. And yet we've tried to adjust to it for so long, we think this is normal functioning. It's not. It's absolutely completely bizarre. It seems as though light is completely insane, doesn't respond anymore. In the true realms, all response of light is instantaneous. So instantaneous, you can call it spontaneous. And it's just a perfect flow, a perfect effortless flow of experiencing without any concern whatsoever, or effort whatsoever. Light instantly provides the tapestry of your experiencing. The full tapestry is always present in reality. The full tapestry, flawless, effortless, spontaneous, instantaneous. That's reality. Here, it seems to be, you know, utterly bizarre. And we say, what's the matter? I want things to be this way, and they're not this way. Oh, I need to wait. Oh, it's not, there's... Oh, the sun is there now, and it's moving there. The light is there, it's moving like there, and I have to, the earth is turning. All these mechanical, you know, situations that have to do with time and space and everything, utter nonsense, utter nonsense. So those of us here that are tired of this nonsense, we have a continuity problem, very severe. We need to be reassured there is another realm where the light is much more responsive. Now, we are frightened of the light being instantaneously spontaneously responsive because we feel we couldn't function there because we're so used to trying to work on adjustments here. And we don't want our thoughts to be instantly followed because some of them are destructive thoughts and angry thoughts and all this. But we're afraid of the light in its true functionality. So light has stepped itself down a number of steps, certainly to get to this realm. It's very step down. Now, we don't have to have the light functioning, you know, the way that, you know, that it really functions, have pure perfect awareness of it right away. We can simply be aware of the next level up where the light is much more responsive to us, much more responsive. Some people call it the astral realm or some higher realm, where the light is way more responsive. You want a tree to grow? A tree grows very quickly. It might not be there instantly, but it might grow very quickly. You see, and what people do here in this world, they try to replicate the astral realm here, which requires slave labor. There are people who say, okay, I want the landscape, I want everything to be planted here and here, okay. And then they look at it and say, you know what? I kind of think like I want it now all changed over here. So you got to change the whole irrigation system, dig new holes, move all the plants, move everything, you know. They say, okay, I'll adjust this over here. What's that? Slave labor. You're telling people to labor like slaves for you, to just keep readjusting things like, oh yeah, this is fine. Well, if I got the money, I got the power, I got the authority, you know, I can just tell people what to do. And they'll just rearrange all the scenery for me like it's the astral realm. But it's blood, sweat, and tears, and bodies, sinews being torn, and just, you know, wearing bodies out. And this has been that way. It's horrible here. It's horrible. I always say, here, if people want to have things changed, let them do it themselves. Let them do it themselves. Don't be a slave here. It's not right. And then very quickly they'll say, hey, I don't like this place so much. You know, that's right. I have always tried to do everything myself, but I'm getting too tired and old to do that now. But of course, that's horrible. You don't like this world. If you do it yourself, you won't like this world. You say, wow, forget it. This is crazy. But if you're rich and powerful and you can hire other people to do stuff for you, then you think, well, you know, if I just get rich and powerful enough and I just get the whole army of people who are willing to do my bidding just like that, snap of the fingers, no back talk, instantly, that's what they want. They want robots. They want robots. What do people want? Robots who, no back talk, just automatically do whatever your bidding is. That's why they love the smartphones and learning to control everything through, you know, wireless control of all the systems. Click the TV. I can just, you know, it's like, hey, you know, this, we don't need to go back home. We can make this place, you know, our home. So in the astral, the higher realm, it's much more satisfying than here, because the light seems much more responsive to what we want. We want to change the color of our house. Just ask and it's changed just like that. We want to have our whole house translucent with shimmering, beautiful shimmering colors. There it is. You know, and on and on and on and on and on. And now there are higher realms above that, where the light is even more responsive. But basically, we need to go step by step, except for some of the great meditation masters who have been able to work through it in you know, tremendous effective meditation. But most of us are not in that kind of situation this time. So it's enough to realize there's a higher realm here. We're not trying to bring that higher realm here to Earth. Absolutely not. That is the worst teaching ever. Okay. We're supposed to say we don't need this realm. We don't need it. Can you imagine God saying that we need a realm that all it does is generate false evidence about God and about light? We need that for what? For self-deception? It's ridiculous. We do not need this realm. And one day we'll all be finished with this realm and it will be no more. That is for sure. Nobody will need it anymore. And then the light will simply stop disappearance. Stop pretending to be non-responsive. Then the astral will be the lowest realm. And most of us will have ascended up through the higher realms until we don't need any realms at all, so to speak, where the light will be functioning the way we were created to function, which is everything is an instantaneous, spontaneous flow. No such thing as time gap or space gap for the responsiveness of light. And so here we are in this realm, and we got the severe continuity problem, and things are about to get way, way worse. Because those who have the severe continuity problem and have not repented, their goal is to control everything and everybody here. And this is the overriding ideology of this planet, is control. Because they want to snap their fingers, and they want everything to be rearranged so they can, it feels like the astral realm, like, oh, the light is responsive to me. It's not responsive to you, but it's responsive to me. So I'm happy at the cost of, you know, utter slavery of everybody else. This is the way this realm is. This realm's terrible. I mean, Jesus came, said, I didn't come to praise the world. I came to condemn it. Came to condemn this world. Or did he say, or save it? I didn't come to save this world. I came to condemn it. And then when he left, they said, why are you leaving? This is your kingdom. He said, this world's not my kingdom. This is the kingdom of Satan, the kingdom of dark, prince of darkness, this realm here. It's not my realm. I'm going to my Father's kingdom. This realm is atrocious. This realm is, if it weren't for the continuity problem, we would have dropped this realm long ago. And the reason why we don't drop it this instant is because of the continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem we really have in this realm. The only problem there is actually in all of existence, meaning these various realms of light stepping down, its response, its apparent responsiveness. Pretending to be less and less responsive until we get to this place where it seems that responsiveness is locked up and imprisoned in nature, in the processes of nature, in the processes of force, and we can try to force changes in nature through, you know, that kind of thing. Materialism, you know. So we have all these secular materialists who think that they found a way to be happy here, you know, drilling to get the oil and refining the oil and turn heating pressure and turning into other stuff. And in the astral realm, there's no need for any natural resources at all. No such thing. Light is the natural resource. Light is the natural resource. It's the one and only natural resource there is, actually. You simply ask light for whatever you want, and there it is. Now, we're afraid of this. We're afraid of the speed of it all. So we don't need to leap into that. And there are lower parts of the astral realm where things don't happen quite as quickly as the higher parts of the astral realm. The next realm, next higher realm. It's enough for the light to come here in this realm to at least people say, hey, I really get this feeling that there's a higher realm than this realm. That is really the best teaching of all, is simply for the light to show up here. And of course, the continuity fear will ask all sorts of questions. Ah, I'm afraid. How do I function like that? But what's more important is for the right brain, the feeling of wholeness, of presence, to be aware that this light doesn't feel like the light of this realm. Okay, it feels like a better light, a more responsive light. And continuity fear may demand responsiveness through answers, through conceptual answers, which are set in the context of this realm. And there isn't any way to solve the problems of this realm except to realize you don't need this realm. So the presence of this light is answering the only question of this realm really has, which is it's not needed. And you have a continuity problem, so let's admit that and start working on it. Possible that we can shift into a low part of the astral realm, where reaction is still slow, responsiveness to the light is still slow. That is very possible. Okay, back. It's certainly possible to have a lower astral realm where stuff doesn't seem to happen, you know, that quickly. And you can adjust to it, and adjust to it, and adjust to it, gradually adjust to it. But it's fundamentally different than this realm now. The mistake that so many have made here is they think they need to bring the light down into this world. Now, for instance, well, there's another mistake. Let's talk the first one. Bring the light down into this world and get this world feeling better. There have been some teachers, there have been some philosophy about that, bringing the light down. And no, that's not the answer at all. There's also been the ones that the ETs who have like parallel realms to this, so to speak, are the same basic realm as the materialistic realm. They're just very clever at manipulating the light here, okay? And so they bring their gadgets and technology here and say, look, we figured out all sorts of ways to manipulate the light. You can really be happy here in this realm by manipulating the light through technology. Okay, that's not the answer either. Both of those are not the answer at all. We can't be remotely satisfied with that. So going into the realm where light is inherently more responsive to us is the answer. Because that realm too, we have to get used to it and transcend that one as well. You're not going to be on transcending the apparent non-responsiveness of light while you're still in this realm here, where everything seems to tell us that the light is not responsive. It develops a gigantic continuity fear here. Gigantic. So you do not want to find yourself back in this realm. That continuity problem is going to arise for you. Unless you're like a perfect savior type. That, you know. But other than that, yeah, it will. Now, the difference of being in a higher realm is that you get this pervasive feeling of friendliness about you. And safety. Friendliness and safety. You have this pervasive feeling of being friendly. Friendliness is everywhere because everything just feels friendly and everything feels safe. Okay. Now, what we have tried to do in this realm here is try to duplicate that feeling of friendliness and safety. We get our nice little communities, crime-free communities. Everybody's supposed to be friendly with one another. We have these, you know, resorts or country clubs and everybody's chummy, etc. We made a big effort to do that, but this is just being absolutely obliterated right now. This sense of friendliness and safety is being obliterated. It was just a very mild feeling of, hey, I know them, they're like me. We have common education, we have a common religion, common beliefs. We live in the same neighborhood, we're happy to be here. We've got to live in a beautiful, there's no crime, we're kind of leave our doors unlocked, we come visit each other, you know, that's the ideal in this realm, okay? That's just a very, but still, there's a pervasive, all-pervasive feeling of danger here. Danger, we must protect from so much, and not so friendly. There's lots of not friendly forces everywhere, but we kind of isolated ourselves from it. That's about the best we can do here. That's being obliterated now in this world. This world now is the difference in 50 years here. It feels so much more dangerous now in this world. Incredibly more dangerous. And incredibly less friendly. Where this political correctness, you know, is just stifling. Everybody feels on guard, you know. And these cliques that are forming now, and these power pushes, you know, it's just this horrendous. You're feeling the fangs of this world right now. Really feeling the fangs. To me, it feels like an incredibly unfriendly place, incredibly unsafe place. And that's the way that this realm is meant to function. It's meant to give us this feeling. That's what it's all about. So all our little efforts here to try and transform this world have turned into dust, actually, which is kind of shocking. It definitely shocked me and has caused me to have a lifetime of effort to say, wow, that doesn't work. It doesn't work at all. You know, there's just so much unwelcome invasion into our lives. I mean, there's a, I just read online, there's this NSA whistleblower who left the agency in, what, 2001, has come out and said that the goal of the NSA is global population control, to control everyone. They're spying on everyone. That's their goal, is to just collect data and spy on everyone in every possible way, and they're tyrants. You know, this is a very severe whistleblower. And so there are these whistleblowers coming out and say, hey, guess what, folks, you know, You don't live in Kansas anymore. This is nasty stuff. And this is just the tip of the iceberg of what's happening here. It is the technology that has been shared by aliens, actually, who themselves are very nasty in many ways, who try to manipulate the light and to get happiness in this realm, and they don't understand all the unintended consequences. Severe social engineering is taking place here. I mean, it's just an absolute nightmare, the future, to tell you the truth. In many ways. Of course, you can always say you see silver linings because some things seem to get better and other things seem to get worse, you know. I mean, oh, we eradicated smallpox, you know, people say, well, you know, things, the world's getting better because you did stuff like that. And they, of course, then they find vials, you know, stored in some cabinet somewhere, cleaning it out. Oh, whoops, you know, smallpox vials. Oh, yeah, oh, something happened to get out, you know, out in the world. There's always threat here. That's the purpose of this realm. The purpose of this realm is to seem threatening. The purpose of this realm is to seem, is to make it seem that there's vulnerability and threat and all this. So why do we even need this realm? Do we need to transform it? Why? Why not just go someplace where there's not that threat? Where there is, it is friendly. Now the friendliness comes in the higher realms. It doesn't come from any person. It's in the air, so to speak. It's all around you. You're surrounded by this feeling of friendliness, of care, of compassion. It's the light. It's the light itself feels this way. And you say, oh my gosh, wherever I go, I feel the supportiveness. I feel the safety. Nothing can happen to me against my will. Whatever I want is what's going to happen. How friendly is that? You know, there's a super supportive friendliness in the higher realm. Higher realms than this, for sure. It's because the light is not so stepped down. In our request to for the light to disobey us, so to speak, to disobey us, to not serve us, the light stepped itself down bit by bit by bit. So it wouldn't seem to be too shocking for us. So this is like the lowest realm here, where light seems to be completely disobedient to us and is serving some other master, nature. In the next higher realm, it seems that, you know, the light is somewhat responsive to us. And it's like friendly. We feel, wow. I mean, we can't believe the difference, how friendly it feels compared to this realm, how safe it feels compared to this realm. Now, we can experience the higher realm while we're still here, but the purpose is not to try and transform this realm into the higher realm. The higher realm already exists. Why do we need to transform this one? That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous. But we can experience the higher realm while we live here and feel the supportiveness and friendliness and invulnerability. While we live here, it's possible, for sure it's possible. But again, the people of this realm who think they need this realm will say, oh, here's a super person, here's a miraculous saint here to show us how to make this realm a happy place, how we can make this our home. That's not the purpose at all. It's not the purpose at all. That's why they ask the saints, oh, come on, help us take over the world here. They say, no, I've got no interest. Jesus said, no, I'm not going to be the king of this world. This is not my kingdom. That's obvious. Okay, obvious what they're talking about. So when the light comes into this world, someone accepts the light of the higher realms in this world, it's to showcase the higher realms, not to try and transform this one. So they are not some transformative being. They are not, we're not here to be transformative beings at all. We're here to help people repent. We're assurances, reassurance, encouragement, reassurance to repent, not transformative beings at all. This is a misapprehension, a mis misperception of what's going on. And most people say, well, I have to die until I go lie around. So most people, the problem is the continuity fear they have pulls them back into this realm because they think they need it. They haven't really repented. But certainly, after you die, usually you will feel more free and a little more safe, etc. But it doesn't go any further than that, and you find yourself, you know, back where you think you need to be, saying, how do I transform this place so it's like heaven? You know, no, heaven is heaven. We have heaven. We have reality. Why do we need to transform a situation built on a false premise into a heavenly kingdom? That's crazy. That's the Luciferian satanic agenda, is us deceiving ourselves, really. It's saying we can have a false premise and yet have true outcomes of that, have truth based on a false premise. The false premise being that the ground of being, the pure spacious, the zero dimensionality, the light, which is God, that it has preferences of our freedom. We're perfectly free. God creates perfectly free. How then can God have preferences for us of how to use that freedom, that we have to use it in this way or that way? No, we're free. But reason tells us that to use our freedom to try and restrict our freedom, although we're free to do that, is not what we really want. It's very unsatisfying, and we found that out. And yet we keep trying to use our freedom to restrict our freedom and then to be happy with the restriction of our freedom. You see, that's the false agenda. So the light comes from the higher realms appear, and people say, oh, great, here's someone who's going to help us be happy with the restriction of our freedom. With permanent restriction of our freedom, we can be happy. We can learn to be happy with that. We can adjust to that. Not true. That is not true. Now, God created us perfectly free, but God never said that we're going to be perfectly happy trying to restrict our freedom, trying to say that we're not free. They did not say that at all. As a matter of fact, we're going to be feeling like we don't exist, there is no identity, like we feel like we'll lose our identity. We end up with a severe continuity problem. Absolutely. God said, don't eat the fruit of the tree in the middle of the garden, which is freedom, which is all potentiality, okay? All possibilities, total freedom. If you try to restrict that, if you try to restrict it, then you're going to feel good and evil, like preferences, right? Preferences. Good and evil is all about preferences. Before that, there was no preferences, total freedom. We tried to restrict our freedom. We tried to say that God has preferences. There we become then flesh, and this realm arises here. The stepping down the light results in this realm, and here we are, suffering hideously and hating it. Good and evil, oh, you know, it's preferences. God prefers this, God condemns this, and you get into all these teachings of what does God condemn and what does God prefer, and you know, and remember, all those teachings are pragmatic. They do not indicate preferences from God. They indicate pragmatism from the Holy Spirit, which is the reasoning, the voice of reason that God created to help us with this continuity problem we have. In other words, it's saying, look, you need to overcome the continuity problem in order to realize you don't need this realm. So these are the pragmatic steps you can take that will help you do this. And that's what religion's about. It doesn't mean that you're not free. You're free not to not do this also. But from a pragmatic standpoint, it won't solve the continuity problem if you don't do this stuff. You won't solve the continuity problem. You'll continue to think that you're stuck in this realm. Ultimately, what you have to see is the prison bars of this realm aren't prison bars at all. They can't bind you. Ultimately, you have to see that. And then you realize, I don't even need this realm. I'm not even stuck here. How do you realize that? Well, a lot of work. It's very tough. It's very difficult. And the religious teachings tell us how to order our lives and our socialization so that it provides optimum opportunity for us to work on this continuity fear and to get it less and less and less and less and less. The commandments, for instance, whether they're Mosaic commandments, Jesus commandments, Muhammad commandments, you know, the Hindu teachings, the Buddhist teachings, the Baha'i teachings, the Judaic teachings, the Talmud teachings, you know, that's Moses and the tradition. All, you know, various traditions, Mormon tradition, you name it. There's lots of traditions. What those are intended for is to help us structure our time in such a way is that we are able to feel that, you know what, I can sit here quietly. I have some time here to really melt away this continuity fear in a quick fashion. And that is, you get these bursts of insight from the Holy Spirit, from God within us, and this shocks us. Like, whoa, you mean we don't need this realm? That's very shocking, because I think, no, I think my identity, this is my identity, this is my home, and you realize you don't need it. It's shocking, and you need to go through this spiritual path of being shocked bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. You get shocked many little steps. That requires a certain kind of lifestyle that is slow-paced, that is calm community. It's not hustle, bustle, dog eat dog, people share, people help one another. It's a pace that you feel like, hey, it's okay if I just sit here very quietly and spend time in prayer, contemplation, meditation, quietude, stillness, religious reading of high spiritual teachings of various types. That's the right way to overcome the continuity problem. Now, God is not saying we have to do this. See, there's no preference from God. But the Holy Spirit was created as a pragmatic, to be pragmatic. And so the Holy Spirit says, look, this is what will work for you. Now, you don't have to do it. But if you don't do it, don't expect that it's not doing it is going to work for you. It won't. So we through our free will can choose to follow the Holy Spirit's advice. We can choose. See, choice is different than need, preferring, saying that God has preferences. We, Spirit, of course, we choose different experiences because I want to choose this, I want to try this. That's what we were created to do that. Now you can quote-unquote call that our own preferences. That doesn't mean God is preferring anything that we're choosing. We're free. God created us free, and that's it. So that's our choice. So we can choose to listen to the advice of the Holy Spirit and to receive the insights from the Holy Spirit, which are quite stunning, because it's very different than what we think, what we've grown accustomed to in all our, you know, this believing in all this false evidence. The light is not responsive to us. The Holy Spirit will say, that's not really true. You're just, you know, and he'll tell us many teachings that come to us. Even without a book, they will naturally come to us from within. The real teacher is within. The Holy Spirit is within us. It's within our minds. It's within our spirit. And there's a way to accelerate this freeing up yourself up from the continuity fear. There's a way to accelerate it. So religions exist for the purpose of accelerating this process. Now, people who have not repented have incredibly severe continuity fear. They don't even want to believe that in religion. They say it's all nonsense, because what they want to think is there is no way to go anywhere else. This is it, you know. So we can just throw all our efforts in trying to adjust to this realm. any thought of this isn't it frightens the material, secular, this universe, this realm is it. That's all there is. The bodies are our identity. And all we're supposed to do is try to be happy, figure out a way to be happy here. And they don't want to hear anything or be aware of anything that disturbs this little equation that they have. And so religion disturbs this little equation, which is an extremely fragile equation. It's like a house of cards. The slightest breeze, the whole house of cards will come tumbling down. So they want to remove the slightest breeze of truth, of spiritual pragmatism from this world. They really want to remove it all, which is what NSA is busy trying to do, is get data on everybody, have a global police state, essentially. And essentially what it'll be is the higher-ups will say, well, you can't spy on us because we don't like that, but we have to spy on everybody else. So there'll be this stratification. Totalitarian dictatorship is what arises. They can't stand any religion. See, I love all religions because I understand the pragmatism behind them. And that's their real function. As far as the accuracy of their theologies, etc., like that, well, that's for a higher understanding. Most people are not able to understand the higher, the true theology. They cannot. They're not abstract enough to zero preferences, zero dimensionality. That's a very high teaching, and they can't get it here. A very difficult time. It's very difficult to get it here. The true theology is very difficult. So, of course, their theologies are all, a jumble for sure. And arguments arise over that. Should not be arguing over theology. It should be following the prescriptions and advice of the Holy Spirit as to how do you structure your life. It's very important. What's your environment? What are your friends? What are you reading? All this stuff. Where are you putting your attention? That is where the Holy Spirit works with you. Where are you putting your attention here? It's all important. Holy Spirit told me stop watching television. Back in, it was almost 20 years ago now, it's been 15, 20 years ago. Stop watching television. That's it. You've done enough. I asked you to watch it just to so you could truly get a sense of it. You're not being deprived, and now it's time to stop. If you don't stop, you're going to fail, okay, in what we're trying to do here. That's it. And I stopped. For a long time, to stop. And since then, it's been severely restricted. Now I can watch a baseball game, a few innings maybe, watch a little bit of this, a little bit, but most of the time, no. Just check it out, okay, that's it. Most of the time. This is super, 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 super limited. There are sometimes I've fell back and watched a little bit, but I felt like, this is horrible. Gotta stop this. That's your attention. So the Holy Spirit tells you where should you put your attention. Gives you the advice. You're free to disregard its advice, but every time I've disregarded its advice, I found I have suffered greatly. Like I said, why did I do that? The Holy Spirit says, stop looking at the paper. You know that there's been these grisly stories there that just make you feel hideous. They're always in the media somehow. Super grisly, horrific story that just makes you feel awful inside. Always. Inescapable. This the way this realm functions, the way the media functions. They want to impress upon you there is no higher realm. How could there be a higher realm? With this stuff's happening here, it makes you feel disheartened, like, wow. Maybe there could, how could, if there's a higher realm, how could it even allow this to happen? You see? That's what they're trying to impress upon you, actually. They always say, well, if there's a God, how could God allow this to happen? Well, God... that brings us to the theology and great abstraction, which is beyond the capacity of most of us here. I've spent a lifetime here of intense study, nonstop. It's been my whole decade, my entire life. So of course, I am able to understand more advanced theology, but it's not easy. And for sure, most of the teachings about it are completely off, but it doesn't matter that much. What's important is the discipline, time spent listening to the Holy Spirit. Attentive, saying, I feel a breakthrough is coming, I'm going to make time here, and I'm going to spend time quietly. And I'm going to discipline my thought patterns and mind. I'm not going forward, I'm not going back, I'm not going parallel. Okay, I'm right here, right now. As I say, light here, light now. Yes, yes, yes. Fresh, fresh, fresh. Not right here, right now. Light here, light now. So this is a very powerful saying. Light here, light now. Light here, light now. Light here, light now. Use that as a sledgehammer. Light here, light now. Light here, light now. I am light here, light now. Yes, yes, yes. Fresh, fresh, fresh. Okay, I am light here. I am light now. Yes, yes, yes. Fresh, fresh, fresh. Because we need to say yes to this light. Yes. Fresh, yes. These grisly stories that they put in, that the media keeps, constantly embedding. They're very tricky now. I've noticed that they're super, super sly and tricky. They'll give you a video of a cat, a funny cat, and you say, I want to watch this or something. And they go through and they see the cat and they say, okay, that's a great video. And then they actually have a playlist. Well, automatically the next video will start and it's something ghastly and grisly or shocking or frightening to you. You say, no, 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 I don't want to, no, no. You see, very diabolical here. The Luciferians, Satanists are extremely diabolical and tricky and malevolent here in how they try and bring us about the state of abhorrence, where we shut down and contract. What we're trying to do is we're trying to open up and welcome the light, the presence of the light here. Yes, yes, yes. The feeling of friendliness, the feeling of safety. When you see these grisly stories, you get a feeling of danger and unfriendliness. You contract. So, we're saying, stay away from those stories. Light here, light now. Yes, yes, yes. Fresh, fresh, fresh. This is the seed exercise the Holy Spirit gave me today. And I'm sharing it with you. For anyone who wants to use it, it is powerful. It is very powerful. It is able to turn around the whole mood, your whole mood, and push this realm away from you, so to speak. Light here, light now. Yes, yes, yes. Fresh, fresh, fresh. You see, there's this, in the higher realms, there's this feeling of freshness that pervades everything. It is friendliness, it is safety, it is freshness that pervades everywhere. Now, this realm tries to fake that. You go into a supermarket, they've got the Muzak on. It's a friendly place. Everyone smiles, hi, how are you? The cashier's friendly, safe. It seems like the supermarket seems a very safe place. And there's all this abundance, all these products. Fresh. Everything seems fresh, 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 fresh. I spend a lot of time in supermarkets, actually. I'll go to three different supermarkets. And because it gives you this feeling, friendly, safe, fresh. I mean, as long as I'm here, I'm safely, friendly, safe, and fresh. Just look at all the fresh food. It seems so nice. It's a faint reminder of the higher realms, But it's not enough. It's not enough. People love to go shopping. Okay, safe, friendly, fresh. Safe, friendly, fresh. But it's such an incredible, crummy facade, like something made in China, where you get it out of the box and you try to use it and it breaks. A friend of mine bought this knife, and it's supposed to be like $100 knife, got it real cheap on sale, etc. It lasted for about a month before it broke. Now, it became very dangerous. A month. Someone else will buy a knife, a good knife made someplace that cares about quality. That knife should last you 20, 30 years, maybe even a lifetime, actually. He also said that the metal, when you sharpen it, you use it for a couple days and it goes dull again. A good knife, you sharpen the blade, it can last you, you know, a long, long, but holds its edge for a long time. That's a good knife, right? You know those good knives when you get them, kitchen knife. That kitchen knife can go for like, what, 6 months to a year before you need to sharpen it. I mean, it holds its edge for a long time. The cheap ones lose their edge right away. So, this world is, whatever we try to do in this world, it's like that. It's cheap, it's crummy, it falls apart. It takes so much effort to provide even the simplest mirage. Like a golf course, I've heard it costs about $500,000 a year to mow the grass of a golf course. $500,000. You go there, you get this impression of everything's fresh because they keep everything watered constantly and trimmed and everything. You say, wow, it's very fresh here. You see, it's very fresh. It feels very safe there. Gated community, everyone's, and friendly. Safe, fresh, and friendly. The supermarkets and golf courses are two of the best places for that, actually. But that's where I spend my time. Supermarkets and golf courses. Because it reminds me a little bit, you know, of the higher realm. Safe, friendly, and fresh. That's what marketers try to do here. It's safe, hey, safe, friendly, fresh. But it's very much a Pyrrhic victory in this world to try and make it seem like, oh, this is heaven here. This is heaven on earth, you know. What nonsense. What incredible efforts we have to go to. We don't realize, for instance, mowing a golf course, you have to people to get up, you know, the crack of dawn, before dawn, dark, get out there, cold all year long, just mowing, spend their time mowing the grass of the golf course, you know. Incredible labor is involved in all of this, actually. Incredible amounts of hard labor, and we try to make it seem invisible. I remember these gated country clubs, they have all these incredible flower displays, like in the Coachella Valley, for instance, and everywhere, just flowers, beautiful flowers. And you come back like a little week later, some other time, and all the flowers have changed, all fresh new flowers everywhere. You say, whoa, God must have come with a wand, all his angels, and just changed everything. No. What happens is they set up lights at nighttime on a weekend, I believe. And these crews, large crews, work all night long. Okay, they start you know, in the evening and into the early morning they work, and then they disappear. And what they do is in a couple of days they literally replace all the flowers in all these flower beds. It's just unbelievable what they do. So the people who live there never even notice, never even see them, never even notice anything. Just they drive through and just say, oh my gosh, all fresh new flowers everywhere. This gives the illusion of fresh, friendly, and safe. These you know, gated country club communities is the illusion of fresh, friendly, and safe. I know some, you know, some very nice ones. The incredible flower displays. So it just feels, and I know that as I was given a tour of one of those, these ones, a sales tour, so to speak, the Holy Spirit told me to do it. And the person giving the tour, she said, look, this is what we do here. Every time you come across somebody, she was driving this golf cart, and she said, every time she came across somebody, she stopped saying, hi, so-and-so, nice to see you, wonderful to see you today. How are you today? Wonderful. And then you go on the next one, same thing. Hi, great to see you, you're looking wonderful. Hi, waving. Okay, she says, we ask all our patrons here that live here, our community members that live here, to do this, that they're supposed to do this. Everyone they meet, they're supposed to smile and say, I'm really friendly. I'm really friendly. I'm really safe and I'm really friendly. It's a purposeful thing. She said, this is actually our rules here. I said, wow. So you combine that with an army of lawnmowers and manicurists who keep the golf courses looking immaculate, like they just came down from heaven this morning, with the gated community and security patrols where nobody, you know, there's safe, supposed to be safe. And then everybody's smiling and saying how wonderful to see you. Everyone is being very friendly. So safe, friendly, and fresh is what people are desperate for here in this world. And the rich have tried to get this feeling. And in case you haven't noticed, the rich are getting richer. Okay. In case you haven't noticed, the one percenters are getting way, way richer now, and the rest of us are falling into more and more into poverty. So this whole nonsense idea of we're all going to be in these wonderful country clubs was totally bogus. Okay, that's a pie in the sky promise here. It doesn't work that way, because it's never enough here. It is never enough. This world is inherently deceptive, and we never feel safe enough. We never feel there's enough friendliness. We never feel the light is truly supporting us here at all, no matter where we live. Okay, no matter where we live or whatever. So we always want more. And the one percenters, of course, rig the system. Whoever's in power, always are rigging the system. Always. Always. Look at China. They tried to stop that, prevent that now. And now it's being rigged again entirely by, you know, super billionaires there. Yeah. It always goes the same way in this realm. And we keep trying to fix it. It's stupid to try to fix this realm. It is the height of stupidity to try and fix this realm. Just simply realize you don't need it. That's all. You don't need this realm because you have the higher realms already. They're there. Not going anywhere. They're not going anywhere. Now, while you're here in this world, of course, you say, well, I'd like to have safe, friendly, and fresh. Absolutely. But that can come from inviting the light of the higher realms in and accepting it and saying, so this is the purpose of spiritual practice. Now, it's difficult practice for sure, and you may find yourself in a safe, friendly, and fresh place in order to help out with this practice. That is possible. I mean, it's not necessarily easy to do when you're in an unsafe, unfriendly, unfresh place. You can. And in fact, sometimes that pressures you even more. Say, wow, you know, this world's really nasty. This is terrible. I really want to work even more on this, right? So you might find yourself in an unsafe place, rockets may be falling, you know. And you say, whoa, this is terrible. I hate this place. Or you might find yourself in an unfriendly place. Nobody likes you. You say, wow, this is terrible. So it doesn't always follow that you're going to find yourself in a safe, friendly, fresh place. It doesn't necessarily. You might lose motivation there. It's possible. And you say, ah, oh, this is good enough. This is good enough. What a nice world this is. And you have the rich people. And of course, they act like, hey, this is world's safe, friendly, and fresh place for everybody. Because that's all they know is their little havens, you know. And they expect, I remember someone told me that they work for all these rich people, and these rich people, it's a maid, and these rich people are taking vacations all the time. And they said to her, says, hey, have a great time off, have a great time off. You know, they say, well, we can't use you now because we're on vacation. Well, you get time off. They say, isn't it great to get time off, have a great time off. And they're so happy and fresh and friendly. And she says, hey, don't they realize I don't get any income, I don't get any work, I can't pay my bills? I mean, this is like hell for me. What are you talking about? So the one percenters live in a dream world here where they're not out of touch with, you know, the rest of the struggle, the rest of the world. They don't live in a nice realm at all. And people hate them. It's not a safe realm for them. It's not a friendly realm for them. It's not. It's a delusion to think we can turn this realm into a safe, friendly place. It's the one percenters promote that so that we keep buying into their system, the system here, which they have rigged, and so they can easily turn us into slaves, is what happens. And they say, well, and then they give us crumbs and say, well, don't you want to, you know, have a little crumb here? It's better than nothing, right? And we say, okay, and nothing I can do about it. And then we become their willing slaves here, you know, working on their great estates, making them feel like, hey, they're living in heaven here, which, of course, they're not. Not from a practical standpoint. Actually, we're always one choice away from perfect, you know, from experiencing exactly what we want to truly experience. But we don't realize that. Continuity fear prevents that. Prevents it. We could instantly be dwelling in true paradise where the light is perfectly responsive to us. And we're aware of that. But the continuity fear prevents that from taking place. We're too afraid. Too afraid. So, pragmatically speaking, this world here is just awful. So once you realize this, you will not want to come back to this world as a one percenter. In my previous life, I was a one percenter for sure. As a matter of fact, I stayed in the guest, actually, in the highest, richest of the greatest moguls and richest people. And so now in this lifetime, this is very opposite. I've been, my whole life, I felt this screaming lack of money and influence, you know, just horrible. Even though I'm lower middle class, my health collapsed on me and I never had any of my own money at all. I've just been incredibly without any resources. And then I've been able to see the world from that standpoint and I said, wow, just and see the one percenter, see how it really works. I said, forget it, you know. Nah, I'm not gonna return to this realm. Even if I was the richest person in this realm and the most powerful and influential, forget it. No chance of that. If I ever returned to this realm, it would be as a bodhisattva, saint, savior, a guru, enlightened one, etc. That's the only possible way I would ever return to this realm. But even that, the thought of that is so hideous that I don't even want to think about it. The suffering, the misery of this realm, the groaning agony of this realm, really, it's horrible. As I think I was pulled into it just out of pity this time again. Like, I thought I could do something about it. That's the one percenter delusion. I had the one percenter delusion that, hey, you noblesse oblige, you know. Nobility needs to oblige. And I said, I can come in here. Let me help out. Let me have the wills. Good intentions, but stupid. Because I wasn't a real one percenter because I worked my way up through just tremendous musical talent. And the one percenters wanted me around because it gave them great prestige, and great beautiful music, in which they thought helped their experience of friendly, safe, and fresh. Like, and oh, I got this, you know, on demand, hey, sit down and play me something. You know, being in the mansion, they'd say, hey, could you play me, our children, our family, could you give a recital for us? And I'd say, sure. I'd sit down and I'd just play this incredibly great music, beautiful music. And I'd say, wow, life is great. Look at this. We live in this mansion. Got everything we could possibly want. Everyone around us is friendly. Servants bowing, smiling, safe. It's we got bodyguards, safe, fresh, friendly. Everything is new. I can buy anything I want new. And now I have this new, fresh music here. Just on demand, you know, live, on demand, fresh music, which is how the rich aristocracy have functioned throughout history, is on demand live music, okay? That's an essential component of it. So I was one of those who could provide on demand live music and was, you know, very, 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 very beautiful. So I was welcome there, but I actually grew up in extreme poverty. In my previous life, extreme, tough poverty, horrible. But I worked my way up because of my musical ability to the highest echelons of power and prestige and entitlement. But I said I didn't come from there. I had some perspective on it. So this lifetime, I maintained some of that perspective and. I was able to say, hey, you know, let's look at this whole situation here and find out what's really going on here, actually. I don't want to spend my time entertaining rich people. Not that I'm condemning them. I could do it, I understand that. But there's something more important here than trying to be happy at all costs here. Okay, there's something about let your life be just kind of miserable and don't try to make this world perfect or make yourself happy in this world through manipulating the world and the resources and all that. Turn your attention to the higher light, the higher realms, and see how you can get into those higher realms and stay there and not have to come back here. And see how you can get that light, the higher realm, to come into this world, at least for your sake, so that you at least start getting used to that higher realm, well, even while you're here. I said, you know, use your life that way. Don't try to use it to just use the leverage you can use and keep leveraging yourself into higher positions of power and entitlement here. You know, been there, done that. Doesn't satisfy. Ended up back in this world anyway. You know, maybe through continuity habit and maybe through some sort of compassion. But certainly, I'm not coming back here unless it's from a standpoint of total enlightenment. No way. The thought of that is truly, again, hideous. I would not like anybody to ask me to do that, really. Enough is enough. This world is incredibly tricky, and for sure you're going to foul up and trip up unless you're perfectly established in the non-preferential truth of reality. You're going to be tripped up here, and when you get tripped up, it tends to snowball on you. One moment. Okay, I'm back. Now, without having to pick up the thread of the previous talk, one of the important things is getting ready for the higher realm is you don't have to follow through on any thread of thought. But here, it's all about process. We have to master process there. You can drop up a thought, you can pick up another. There's no fear about that. Because light is responsive. Here we think light is only responsive if we learn how to, you know, become very technically skilled at process. It's not so. I lost my previous thought too, which is okay. A train of thought there, so lost that too. Had a very nice train of thought. Well, that too gets dropped in talking about dropping trains of thought. There you go. And any train of thought at all can occur. So don't force it. Don't force it. This gets you ready for the higher realm. Our purpose here is to get ready for the higher realm. Now there may be some people here. Well, here was a train of thought. For example, let's say you paint a house in the color. You say this color, and you say, "Oh my gosh, it's tinged with gray. You know, it's got a gray tinge to it." I say, "Yeah, wow. This world is colored by attitudes here, and the fact of the matter is that what has happened on this planet, whether people want to admit it or not, the present overall color of this world, as it were, is heavily tinged by the gray Zeta Reticulans, the gray aliens, the small aliens with the kind of big triangular heads and the big eyes, you know, heavily tinged with that. Plus, it's been heavily tinged by the reptilian aliens, very heavily, as well as the Nordic aliens, who some say they work for the reptilians. As do the Zeta Reticulans. But there are different alien groups that have heavily colored the paint, the color of this world right now. That has changed drastically in the last 50 years. From living prior to this massive infusion, alien infusion of this world, and now seeing how it is now, night and day is so different. The coloration of this world, the emotional, spiritual, the overall coloration of this world has now been heavily infused by these alien groups, even though they've been very sneaky about it, or at least they believe they have. That's part of the delusion of this place, that you can be sneaky. Now, actually, it's been very obvious, but those who don't want to believe in what is self-evident, they don't seem to see it. You know, it's right in front of them, and they're looking up here, down. Where is it? I can't see it. It's right there, you know, they don't see it. It's right present. Wow, okay. It's been very blatant and obvious, but they thought of it as being very sneaky. And, you know, that many of us don't like that at all, as a matter of fact. Not at all. I mean, it's not as vibrant. It is not, you know, it's getting worse here. It's getting worse as technique to manipulate the light technically has become so important here. Now, the World Cup, the match with Brazil and Germany represented the differences about the old style, the old world style of Brazil, which emphasized religion, emphasized prayer. You know, it did not emphasize technique, materialistic technique. Okay, and the Germans, which emphasized materialistic technique, very much so, which is why they were so, you know, powerful in Europe. They raised, you know, they were such powerhouses through the Holy Roman Empire, through the Prussian Empire, really, and then, you know, the German Empire, World War I, World War II. They were way more technically advanced than the rest of the world, way ahead. That's why in World War II, they seemed that they were going to conquer the world, control the world. They had all sorts of technology that, where they get it, it's a question, right? Did they have alien sources? Did they have, you know, sources on this planet that were in contact with aliens, actually? Call them black masters or something like that, you know, who are showing them how to, you know, tear apart matter more easily, and chemistry and weaponry, and a lot of it. They had a lot of amazing advancements technically. So Germans now are, you know, very technically advanced in this day and age. So the Germans' attack against the Brazilians, you know, was just wow. You could see the difference. The Brazilians are just like, hey, don't you appreciate, you know, the beauty and the style and the spirit of the game? And the Germans said, boom, 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 goal. Brazilians are like, what? You know, like, wow, no respect for us. You know, we're Brazil. This is our country. You know, the people love us. This is our heart. You don't respect that? No. No. See, the Brazilians thought the Germans would respect the situation. They did not. They did not. And it shocked the Brazilians. It really did. That's the problem. That's the problem they had. Is this is our country. All the people here are feeling the utmost love and love of us right now. And expecting us to make them happy. So they say, the Germans, you don't want to cause 200 million people to be distraught, do you? That's not right, is it? I mean, we're hosting you, right? We spent billions of dollars building these stadiums. We're hosting this tournament. Have some respect for us. Have some respect for the situation. Germans, all technical. All technique. What's the technique? Okay, this, pass here, one touch, pass, one touch, pass, one touch, boom, goal. Blitzkrieg. It was a blitzkrieg. And of course, very shocking for the Brazilians. So this is the new world order. Okay, this is the new world order. I'm not saying the Germans are the new world order. I'm saying this mentality is a new world order. And of course, the Germans are certainly leading that in Europe. I mean, they're very powerful again in Europe, right? And in the world. And of course, the German educational system, the education system in the United States has followed, as most of the really highly progressive worlds have followed the Prussian educational system. So they're all about technique too. They miss the honor, they miss the respect, they miss the, you know, the bigger picture of the situation. They're all about technique, meaning how can we be make the right adjustments to be happy here in this world, to get the light to do what we want it to do, at least in a physical way. How to force it, how to force the light to be responsive is what technology is all about, is how can we force light to respect us here. Where in religious, more prayerful places, we say, hey, light, we repent. We realize that somehow we didn't ask you properly. We're sorry for this. and we repent. We want to get you more responsive to us. Can you please help us out, Holy Spirit? How can we get the light to be more responsive to us? That's the religious, repentant way. That's the way that lifts you up into the higher realm. The way of trying to force the light to be more responsive, thinking that this is, that it's inherently non-responsive to us, but we can find a way to force it, is the way of technology, high tech, and that's the way that, that leads you into great darkness, actually. These ETs are in great darkness, even though they seem to be in great light because they're able to force the light to do what they want it to do here. They're actually in extreme darkness, believing that inherently the light does not respond to them properly, and they have to force it, or that the light is a dead light, and they can find a way for techniques to force it. There's actually no such thing as dead light at all. It appears as though there's dead light here in this realm, but it's not. It's actually the living light. There is only one light, and it is the living light. There is no other light, actually. So the whole idea of there's this dead light, that we can force it to do what we want, is extreme delusion, and it leads to incredibly severe continuity problems. And of course, they don't want to tackle it. They say, wow, it's too difficult. But with the help of the Holy Spirit, it is not too difficult. Without, certainly it would be too difficult. But with the Holy Spirit knows how to use leverage of reasoning to pry away what seems to be massive amounts of difficulty and time. Suddenly you save 1,000 years, just like that. Suddenly you save, you know, even more time. You just right and left, you're saving time with all the leverage it uses. It teaches you the technique of true reason and spiritual leverage to free yourself from the continuity problem. So even those who are in great darkness will eventually be freed. But right now, they keep trying to pursue more and more power, more and more control, so they can force the light to do more and more what they want it to do. So that's the Antichrist way. It's the Antichrist way. So this world is tinged now with very much the Antichrist attitude in this world, very much. And that's why there's this very strong unfriendliness, inhospitality to religion, to spiritual profession of faith by anybody. You know, you feel like, can you profess your faith to anybody? No way. In the past, people loved to hear professions of faith. I mean, they'd love to hear that more than a beautiful, you know, chamber music, live chamber music. They would much rather hear a great profession of faith, you know, really strong. Oh, absolutely, are you kidding? Nowadays, that is seen as a sign of instability, mental instability, impossible, and actually suffering from severe insanity that needs to be treated. That's where it's going. That's where it's going. So, what's this all about? What's this all about? Well, it's reinforcing the overall background of clarity here. Being consistent with the clarity, consistent clarity here. Even in the face of, you know, right now, the house is being repainted. It's chaos everywhere here. All sorts of stuff is going on. Huge, massive changes. And I'm just showing you, hey, consistent clarity, even in the midst of chaos. Now, Argentina will have a different than Brazil with Germany. It won't be so easy for the Germans, because Argentina is not expecting any quarter from them. You see, Brazilians expected honor and respect and appreciation and heart and, hey, you know, be a nice guest. Argentina's not troubled by that at all. They're going to play their game for sure. So it's going to be a much, much more, you know, intense, closer match, I would say. It's not a sure thing the Germans are going to win the match, actually. It's not a sure thing. Now, problems in the world coming up, for sure. For sure. There are easily flashpoints in this world. The idea that the safety, freshness, and friendliness here is somehow totally protected is nonsense. We've already seen with 9/11 how that is not true. There are many situations that could occur in this world that would be flashpoints for global turmoil. We're on the brink of global turmoil anyway, actually. The signs of the Middle East is just an absolute mess. Okay, that whole region, all the way, actually, you know, Pakistan and India are an absolute mess. Maybe the worst situation there is. You go all the way through that whole area. Africa's a mess. You know, Russia, with Crimea, that's Ukraine. That's a mess. China with everyone's a mess. It just goes on and on and on and on. How unstable this planet actually is right now, and how some false flag could, you know, by someone who wants to provoke chaos here, could easily plunge the world into global conflict. What does chaos promote? Insecurity, lack of friendliness, lack of freshness, feeling everything that's dying, being destroyed, blown up, etc. There's no freshness there. There's no friendliness there. Everyone's fighting and screaming and hating each other. No friendliness. And of course, no safety by threats to our well-being in every possible way. So what it's doing is trying to saturate our psyche with this lack of freshness, friendliness, and safety, so that we do not even consider that there could be a place that actually is safe, fresh, and friendly. We don't even consider it. We think, wow, must be impossible. Look at this. Our attention, it wants our attention on conflict. So our attention doesn't turn to the higher realms. And we accept the light of the higher realms even while here. And it is possible to actually ascend to the higher realms without even dropping your body. Now, many people may want to drop their body during these times, and to reassure them that, hey, you can go to the higher realm, you don't need this realm, to give them that sense of reassurance is super helpful for them. You know, there may be some that physically actually ascend without dropping their body. There may be those who will drop their body and say, I don't want any more of this world, and I just feel like dropping my body. They may ascend. Their spirit will ascend into a higher realm. And so getting your attention on the higher realm is very helpful here. Very, very helpful for everybody. Certainly not going to do it by watching this 24/7 broadcast news of an attitude of conflict, of hatred, of incivility, etc., which seems to be being promoted more and more and more everywhere you go. Drastic incivility. The savagery of politics, you know, savagery of the culture wars, severe incivility. All of this, we got to get our attention off of it. Got to get our attention off of that, onto the light of the higher realm, the feeling of the higher realm, which is what's spread. Safety, friendliness, freshness, freshness, safety, friendliness, friendliness, safety, freshness, friendliness, freshness, safety. Safety, freshness, friendliness. Safety, freshness, friendliness. Which means, it's just a shorthand for me, the light seems to be more responsive there. Because it's less frozen, it's less stepped down in our effort to get the light to disobey us, which is to change reality. It would, the light gradually step down. It seems like there's these different realms, different dimensions, where there's kind of a demarcation between them, you know, like a major leap, a quantum leap downwards into darkness, so to speak. So we can make this shift upwards. It doesn't matter what happens here. What happens here doesn't affect the higher realm in the slightest bit. It has no effect on it. Now, parallel dimensions to this, parallel realms, you hear the ETs are all upset because our nuclear, you know, experimentations and radiation and nuclear tests, etc., it affected their realm severely. They say they're really mad about that. They came here and they're trying to stop, you know, try to stop certainly nuclear war, but the nuclear tests are the same thing as nuclear war. I mean, there have been, what, thousands of nuclear tests or something like that, you know? And A lot of stuff we do here, they say, is causes havoc in their realms. So, you know, they're very upset about that. They don't want that. But in the true higher realm, none of that has any effect whatsoever. It doesn't cause any problem. The savagery here causes no problem there whatsoever. It doesn't affect the responsiveness, the light, to the friendliness, the freshness, and the safeness is always with you there. It doesn't matter what's happening down here as far as affecting that. You can still be aware of it. It just doesn't affect it in any way. And compassion is to let people know that it does not affect it in any way. That is compassion. The ones down here, I mean, if the savagery here was affecting the higher realms, what kind of haven would that be for us? We'd first have to say, well, we got to fix everything down here, which is impossible. So you'd feel like I'm totally stuck. Totally stuck. What's important for people here to realize is the higher realms are not affected by the lower, what takes place in the lower. The response, the responsiveness of the higher realms, which gives the feeling of freshness, safety, and friendliness, that doesn't change at all. It's always present. It's omnipresent there. It's always there. So you cannot feel, you know, differently in that realm. You cannot feel unsafe. You cannot feel it's unfriendly. You cannot feel it's not fresh. You cannot. If you want those feelings, you have to go into this realm. Into this realm. If you want to feel that severe fear, you got to come here. This place. That's what it's for. So you can't really change what this realm is for. It is what it's for. That would be, again, just a doubling down on life and being not responsive to you. If you could say, I can force this realm to be different, then you're really saying that light is not responsive at all, but you can force the light to be this way. That's like double, it's even worse, more darkness, actually. It's funny. Those who live in this realm in the beautiful way, you know, with the technical force, etc., they're actually in even lower realm. They're actually like in a sub-basement realm, sort of this realm, because their viewpoint on the light is so skewed. So skewed, they become this very materialistic, atheistic, materialistic, secular, humanistic type. Extremely so. Extremely so. They simply have no belief whatsoever in any higher realm, because their whole lifestyle is built on the premise that light is inert, it's dead, and yet it has to be forced into responding to you. And they're just experts at applying this force. That's the whole premise of their identity here. So they cannot even think about that this isn't true. That there's higher realms, and this realm is just where the light appears to be non-responsive. They can't, if it occurs to them, they feel like they're losing their identity. So they're really stuck, you know, really badly stuck. And maybe I had a lot of compassion for those types because I rubbed elbows with so many of them in a previous life in Europe. Yeah, you know, I was among the highest of the high, and maybe they were my friends, so maybe I had compassion. But they're screaming, "Oh my God, we're stuck! We're stuck! We're stuck! Can you help us? We're stuck! We're stuck! We're stuck!" I said, "I'll try to see what I can do. See what I can do." Because they're children of God too, just the same as everyone else. They just, you know, have gotten into this. They got the continuity for so bad, they've gotten very badly stuck. So I don't hate those people at all. Not at all. I have compassion for them. I understand their situation. It's clear to me just why they feel they're so stuck. And of course, the problem is they will then seize upon you and say, you know, make my life happy here. Play music for me. You know, arrange my life so it's pleasant. So you come in to help them, and then they try to submerge you, is the problem. They're very dangerous to deal with. They really need like a perfect guru, like a Sri Anandamaya Ma. She rubbed elbows with all the higher classes and helped them out because she could do it. But most people cannot, because they're very fearful and very demanding that you do what they want to tell you to do, because they're totally used to forcing the light to do what they want it to do, right? So they see you as the light. They say, I'm just going to force you into do what I want to do. And so you have to be immune to that, which Sri Anandamaya Ma was. But I'm certainly not immune to it. I definitely fell here because of that, because they felt, you know, I can force you to do what I want to do, because forcing the light is what we're used to. So I would say leave the one percenters for the real heavyweights who can help them out. Those are the ones that are really gone far down into some most severe continuity problem. Very, very severe. Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit here. The meek, they'll inherit the kingdom first, really, because they have not gone so far into trying to force the light to do what they want it to do. They kind of just say, let's just let the light do whatever it wants to do here. Just leave it alone. Let's not try and get into technique. Let's just, you know, plant our plants. Let the sun shine upon them. Let's harvest them. That's it. Okay, that's it. Easier for them to ascend to the higher realms. Easier. A lot easier, actually. Because they haven't been trying to force the light to do anything, you see. It's the materialists that have tried, those who tried to force the light, the aliens, they're the ones that have the most severe continuity problem. And that's why this world, they're so in charge of it now. Their fear, their continuity fear, has gotten into to us severely here. And now we're all thinking, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, this is, you know, I can't go back. There is no such place. You know. Their continuity fear has contaminated this planet like a virus, actually. It's the worst virus ever. The severe continuity fear, when it comes on a planet that does not have such a severe fear, is the worst virus ever. It is like a spiritual virus. And that's what's happened to this planet. This planet has been infected with the alien's severe continuity problem and fear because of their long history of trying to force the light to do what they wanted to do, you see. This creates gigantic continuity problem because to go to the realm where they see the light doesn't need to be forced, they feel they just completely freak out and lose their identity. I have no idea how to function there, actually. That's how they feel. So they have infected this planet with a severe continuity problem, which is a problem now for all of us. Now, Jesus told us this infestation would happen. This is what's called the end times. And Jesus told us that in this end times that the world would be invaded, infected by this, you know, incredible, evil, adulterous, you know, wicked generation of really secular, humanistic, materialistic mindset. The worst ever, he said. So bad, the infection would be so bad that even the elect of God, those who really are attuned to the higher realms, would be in danger of developing this continuity fear. You know, danger of falling away from grace, which means taking on the beliefs of the severe continuity fear, so it's in control of you, and you're now no longer repentant, and that's what happens. And you think you need to force the light, you know, that's what happens. That's how bad, he said, it would be, and it certainly is that bad now. So these are definitely the end times. This is it. We have been infected. We have been infected. And everybody's ferociously pursuing technique. I hate technique, you know, I just hate it. I don't like to employ it as little as possible. It just turns me off severely in terms of, you know, high tech and in just the whole attitude of it all, forcing the light, you know, forcing it to do something. Now, of course, when in Rome, do as Romans do, because we live in this age, communicating this way is something that's pragmatic. It's pragmatic. But it's not fundamental to me. It is pragmatic. So I'm doing it to try and help out. But for me, I would just let everything be. Don't invent anything. Don't try to do anything. Just let everything be in the simplest way here. And just let it go. Let nature go. Let the world go. It's not needed. This realm is not needed. This realm is the light pretending to not be the light. Why do we need that realm? We don't. We don't. It was a madcap adventure, at best. A madcap adventure, and that's all it's been. That's all it's been. And you say, I don't need that adventure anymore? You don't need this realm. You do not need this realm. Continuity fear tells us we do, but when we evaporate the continuity fear, we get to a point where we say, I don't need this realm. Don't need to see this realm. Don't need to this realm anymore. I'm really not attached to it. Not attached to it. The sun comes up, comes down, the night comes, all these cycles. Forget it. You know, who needs cycles? No cycles really in the astral realm. There are bigger cycles there, but it doesn't feel so much like cycles there. It really doesn't. And beyond that, there's the higher realms where he feels even less like that. You know, just while you're, but here, you know, we're totally immersed in all these natural nature cycles, which are, and people worship them and try to get them to work for them. That's trying to force the light, find some way to force the light to be responsive here without dropping your premise of wanting, you see, to be wanting for there to be preferences in reality, wanting to change reality. As long as you keep that premise, the light is going to be loyal to that premise. So the more you try to force the light, the more continuity fear you get. It's a vicious circle, it's a double bind. And so the wealthy are very difficult to deal with. That is true. You see, I thought I could. No, I was mistaken. I tried to bring the light to them. I was mistaken. Now, their hackles get up very badly. And they look at you like you're the worst, most dangerous viper in the world when you try to bring something like that up to them. their eyes narrow, you know, and I thought you were my friend. Now you're telling me this. Wow, you're an enemy. This is horrible. So it is not so easy to witness to those rich, powerful people at all. It's way easier to witness to the meek people of the world. Way easier. But of course, the rich are insisting, well, whatever is good, we deserve it, so you have to give it to us first, you know? And so there's this idea, you know, that they deserve it more than others, this entitlement complex they have. I'm not against the rich getting the gospel, because everybody has to, you know, but it's not easy to give it to them, that is for sure. And the rich say, well, if you just help us out, we'll help you out, we'll free everybody. Of course, what happens is they turn the tables on you, and they end up using you to try and, again, force the light, make this light, make this world a happy place for them. That's what happens. All right, well, it has been a great taping. Very happy to get back into my studio here, even though it's still all torn up. I threw a seat here and got some lights here, and all sorts of commotion. Still going, very much commotion in this area. I think this is a new prepping me for the new situation that I have to be able to, you know, tape and do things, even though there's a lot of commotion. None of that commotion means anything. This world, nothing in this world means anything. As Jesus said, there's nothing in this world that reminds you of reality, actually, which is very true. There are some things in this world that can remind you of the next realm, the astral realm. That is true. Absolutely. But as far as what he says, reality, meaning the light being, you know, appearing, not a shred of appearance that is non-responsive, that's reality. He says, nothing in this realm here can remind you of reality, which is absolutely true. I absolutely can see that and agree with it. Nothing here. Nothing. So what use is this realm, really? Only as a springboard to the next higher realm. And then this, you know, need pragmatism to do that. And don't lay up your treasure here in this world where moths corrupt, you know? Don't lay up your treasure here. That's stupid. Instead, prepare for the world that has to come, meaning for the next higher realm. You're supposed to use this here. When you're here, you're supposed to use this to prepare for the next higher realm so you never have to return here. So you get it. You repent it. You understand there's a continuity problem. It's the only problem you have. And you're working on it. You're consciously working on it. All right? That you do not have to return to this world. One-way ticket out of here. So, we'll see where this taping gets us. Definitely need a breakthrough this time. I feel like it needs to come. It needs to come, so maybe I'll do some later. Okay. I do a lot of this taping because it's a way to get used to and familiar with the higher realm. It's at least one little way here to get our attention off of the other stuff. Get our attention off of that. How do you get your attention off of something if there isn't any alternative? This is a great problem I've encountered in this world. I've had the most extreme problem here because there's so little here that truly gives us the flavor of the higher realm. Truly, so little here. And I said, wow, how in the world? Let me do what I can do here and at least help some of us out, help myself out, help some of us out. So there's an alternative. Now, if I'm not taping, where do I turn my attention? I don't know. I don't know where to turn it. I keep looking desperately. I don't want to tape 24/7. That's, you know, where do I turn my attention? Gosh, that's the scary, scary thing. No matter where my attention goes, I say, whoa, that's not it. Whoa, that's not it. That doesn't remind me of the high, you know. So what I really need now is the light itself. You know, the light itself is what I really need now. And let that be here so my attention can be on that, because the world is so badly tinged now with this severe spiritual virus of a continuity fear, so to speak. Of course, the spirit cannot be harmed, but you understand, from a pragmatic standpoint, I'm using language from a pragmatism standpoint, not idealism, pragmatism. See, when you look at idealistically, then you can't understand the language. You think it's all contradicting itself. It's level confusion. You're just contradicting yourself. No, this is the language of pragmatism. And continuity fear. So the problem is continuity fear. You need a pragmatic approach. So looking at it from that standpoint, it's been infected so severely here that nothing seems to have the feeling that you want here anymore. Nothing seems to have that feeling anymore. And that's why I think that there's going to be this ascension, this rapture, something. Because you can't get it here anymore. It's so difficult. So difficult. To even get any feeling at all of the higher realm. So as we're plunging down into darkness right now on this planet, I think the Holy Spirit may say, hey, if we don't ascend quickly off of, into the higher realm, even the lower parts of the higher realm, we may get such a severe continuity fear, we're going to have a whole other cycle. You know, it's a very bad situation. So I think there needs to be an ascension here. Some say 216. It's reasonable, you know. It's very reasonable. The rate of things are going now by 216, you know, the attitude of this world is just going to be so technical and materialistic. Forcing the light, the attitude of forcing the light, that is a severe continuity problem. And if you have a severe continuity problem, you're going to be too afraid to ascend into the higher realm. You'll be too frightened to. So it's a desperate situation in this world right now. So I'm praying for the great saviors, the great helpers, the great those who truly know that God has no preference, who know that all is one love, to help us out this time. There are many who have realized, who have repented. There are many who have repented. We all know the same truth. So I don't put any name on anyone. I just say that attitude, that light, that attitude is needed here, please. Thank you very much. That's it for this one.